Good morning. This is Richard Dimbleby speaking from Victoria Station in London, waiting for the arrival of the King and Queen of Thailand on their state visit. It's a long, long way from the teak forests, the golden pagodas, the white painted elephants and all the glitter and the glamour of Siam to number two platform at Victoria Station, and possibly something of a contrast. But that's the journey that the King and Queen of Thailand will have made via the United States and the continent of Europe, the mainland of Europe, before their arrival here this morning. One wonders on occasions like this whether London couldn't provide some more glamorous portal through which our foreign kings and heads of states could come. But faced with the background of Victoria Station, which cannot be called very beautiful, the southern region of British Railways does its best, and does it on this occasion, I think, nobly well. Long crimson curtains hung with blue and gold tassels, huge six great white vases of flowers, if you like to know the details of your gardeners, auritum lilies and carnations and gladioli and delphinium and blue agapanthus and boughs of lime and hydrangeas and beech leaves, making six great shower bouquets in the royal colours of blue and gold with a touch of white, and very pretty they are. Behind them, the symbols of the golden T's for Thailand. And here, representatives of Siam, of the embassy in London, and leaders of the Siamese colony in London. Short in stature, their faces normally wreathed in smiles. They have a charming way of greeting each other, with the hands held Buddhist fashion in front and a little bow of the head. And they bob and they grin and they grin and they bob to each other. Now for the moment they've heard the national anthem being played in the distance, because I think Her Majesty the Queen is just arriving at Victoria, and so instead of the smiles and the grins, a solemnity takes over the occasion. On the other side there wait the important people who have to greet foreign royalty. Of course you'll know the Prime Minister, Mr. Selwyn Lloyd, Field Marshal Alexander, Lord Lieutenant London, General Burns with the splendid plumed helmet. There's Mr. Butler in the background. There's the Lord Mayor of London, Sir Edmund Stockdale. The two sheriffs are passing by in front of him, Mr. Derry and Mr. Hubert Pittman. There's Admiral Sir Caspar John on the left, the son of the great artist Augustus John. Strange contrast in a way to his father. Sir Francis Festing, the Chief of the Imperial General Staff, a massive figure. Medals. Tom Pike, Sir Thomas Pike, Chief of the Air Staff, on the right. There's General Burns again, commands London. There's the tallest policeman of them all, Sir Joseph Simpson, the Commissioner of Police for the Metropolis, in black and silver, very contrasting uniform. There's Mrs. Cayford, the Chairman of London County Council. And on her left, slightly hidden at the moment, Councillor Everest, the Mayor of the City of Westminster, because we're in Westminster, and therefore the local mayor must do the honours. I see the railway staff have just exchanged little signals to say that the royal train is approaching. So I'm sure that the royal family will be coming out onto the platform. Sir Terence Nugent, the Chief Controller of the Lord Chamberlain's office, whose last official appearance this is, has just gone to fetch Her Majesty. In the background here, Siamese students and members of the colony in London, younger people than the diplomats on the other side, all watching anxiously and armed, as you can see, with Siamese flags. The train is approaching from Gatwick Airport, where the King and Queen of Thailand were met by Princess Alexandra of Kent. And as the line gets itself in position with the Lord Lieutenant at the head and the Prime Minister next to him, so it is nearly 12:30, and we may expect driver Holden to bring the train in on time. There's a signal being given at the end of the platform. And there on the platform has appeared the Queen, at her side the Duke of Edinburgh in the full dress uniform of Admiral of the Fleet, the Queen wearing the most beautiful dress with a light overcoat of lime green net figured and worked all over, and a lovely flowered hat, which we'll see again in a minute. Meanwhile, here the train, just about 15 seconds to go to the right time on the clock, so let us say that there, half a minute to go, let us say the British Railways have done it again. And here driver Holden, with great experience of royal trains, brings in the special from Gatwick. there the Queen watches in this lovely flowered hat, which is all vivid in red and pink. I've never seen anything more attractive than the clothes that Her Majesty's wearing this morning. Other ladies of the royal family we'll see in a moment standing behind her. Mr. Fern, the station master, watches anxiously, his top hat behind him, as the Pullman car comes to the spot. Train stops. Attendants leap down and unwind the steps at the bottom. Porters get out, the Pullman attendants in their very smart blue and white uniforms. And here, King Bhumibol Adulyadej, Thailand, and with him, his most beautiful Queen Sirikit of Thailand, welcomed by Her Majesty. King, young, short, small figure, wearing a splendid sash in vivid saffron, the colour of Thailand. Admiral, uniform, of course, of the Royal Thailand Navy. A moment's conversation between King and Duke. King, a little solemn, because he is a young, very modern, very cheerful monarch who was educated in America, speaks well-nigh perfect English. His queen at his side, renowned for her beauty. The Princess Royal comes forward, the Duchess of Gloucester, the Duchess of Kent, and the Duke of Kent on the right, in the uniform of the Scots Greys, deputizing for the Duke of Gloucester, who has a slipped disc, as you may know. So, royal members of the royal family meet the royal family, and the minor members of our royal family curtsy or salute to the foreign king and queen. And now across for the presentation of the dignitaries on the other side. They move down past Mr. Macmillan and Mr. Butler. Here is the young king, whose name, Bhumibol Adulyadej, given him by the Buddhist priests according to the portents in the sky of the day when he was born, whose names mean Bhumibol, strength of the land, Adulyadej, incomparable might. And so, down the line, past the chiefs of staff of Navy, Army, Air Force, there, a moment's picture of Queen Sirikit, who is 27, whose name Sirikit means the most honored one. Great broad-brimmed hat and a suit of Thai silk, Thailand silk, rich silk, a deep shade of, well, perhaps as a man I would say is a deep mauve. It's an interesting fact that nearly all the women, both members of our own royal family and the members of the Siamese colony on the platform at the moment, are wearing silk, because of course it's one of the great products of Thailand, in the most vivid colours. I've never seen so much colour on this platform too, on any one of these state occasions before. Princess Alexandra, who went down and did the honours at Gatwick Airport, has gone out to the outside, where the Guard of Honour of the 3rd Battalion Grenadier Guards, with the Queen's company colour, the royal standard of the regiment, the band of the regiment, the drums of the battalion, are parading under Major Jeffreys. One of the last ceremonial appearances of the 3rd Battalion Grenadier Guards before it's disbanded at the end of this year. The Guard of Honour, which is below us, out of sight at the moment, has come to attention for the royal salute and the playing of the anthems, as the sun, instead of the rain, at exactly the right moment, breaks out over Hudson's Place at the side of Victoria Station. So King Bhumibol Adulyadej and Queen Sirikit, together with Her Majesty the Queen and the Duke of Edinburgh, come forward for the royal salutes.
Thank you.
You may have noticed that it seemed to take the Major Jeffreys, who was the son of Colonel Lord Jeffreys, the Colonel of the Grenadier Guards, a long time to state the guard, as the saying is, to the king. But he was, in fact, doing it in Siamese, it being a tradition among the foot guards that the foreign visitor is always welcomed in his own language. And so Major Jeffreys has had to learn the familiar words, guard, present, ready your inspection, and the rest of it, in Siamese for the occasion. And they have found it difficult, as it's a very difficult language. One doesn't often find officers of the Grenadier Guards, I think, speaking Siamese, so they can do most other things. Now a moment during which the young king carries out his rapid inspection of the guard. He came to the throne in 1946 at the age of 18, succeeded his brother, King Ananda, who was found shot in the palace in Siam. He too had been a boy king. No one ever discovered what had happened to King Ananda. It remains an unsolved mystery. And in his place came this youngster, because youngster he is. Plays a clarinet, loves jazz, a friend of Benny Goodman, has written popular jazz numbers for the late Mike Todd, for shows in America. A thoroughly up-to-date monarch, but who rules constitutionally in his own great rice-growing and timber-exporting country, which supplies one-tenth of the world's tin, and lies at the gateway to the east, surrounded by states which are oppressed by communism, and itself remains a bulwark against it, rules his country with deadly seriousness. Perhaps he's thanking the guard commander. Probably in impeccable English for his efforts in Siamese. That's only a guess, but I think he may be right. And so back through the fitful sunshine to where Her Majesty the Queen and Queen Sirikit are waiting under the awning, the roof at the side of the station. Now royal duties and welcomes are done, and the sovereign's escort of the household cavalry in the distance, and the royal greys of the procession of state landaws will be moved up in position, Queen's colour there in the foreground, to start the royal procession off on its journey to Buckingham Palace. This is a country far away that our royal family honour today by offering them this traditional journey in the state landaws. A country far away, and yet one that we have had a century of unbroken connection, particularly in trade. The first trade treaty that we signed with Japan was back in the middle of the 19th century. At the beginning of the 19th century, to get my dates right, way back in 1826. And English traders have been going to and from the country for the last 300 years. A country which was ruled by despotic kings for centuries, and then turned itself with a bloodless revolution into a constitutional monarchy with a legislative assembly. And only 2 years ago had yet another bloodless coup d'etat when Field Marshal Sadat took over the country as Prime Minister. And that's the setting against which this young Western King and Queen come to London. They take their place in the landau, and behind, the other members of the royal family will be getting into their carriages. Behind them, those who travel in the cars. Here, Queen Sirikit, young and smiling and beautiful, who has four children that she and the king, to show their knowledge of our language, call the four typhoons. And she sits with the Duke of Edinburgh. When the procession moves off and the anthems are sounded and we see the last picture of it going, let's remember that although they may not find waiting them in London, the teak forests and the white elephants, at least not in the sense in which they understand them, or the golden pagodas of Siam, they will at least find history and tradition and the familiar grey buildings of London and a very warm welcome wherever they may go in the course of the next 2 or 3 days. So orders are given, anthems are sounded, and the procession drives away to Buckingham Palace.